Good morning and welcome to the 30th meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have received apologies from Ross Greer. The first item on our agenda is to take evidence in relation to an inquiry into Scotland's Commissioner Landscape. For this session, we are joined online by Katie McMillan, Director of Research Scotland. I welcome Katie to the meeting and invite her to make an opening statement. Ms. McMillan. Can I hear you?
Thank you. I think someone's in control of whether I can be heard or not, but that's good. Hello, I'm Katie McMillan. I'm from Research Scotland, and thank you very much for inviting me along today. I'll just tell you a little bit about the research. We were commissioned in September 2022 to undertake this research and published in March 2023. And what we were asked to do was look at the role of existing commissioners in the UK and in Scotland. Our brief was very much to explore the role of these commissioners to inform the development of the Learning, Disability, Autism and Neurodiversity Bill, which included a potential new commissioner. And within the brief, there was an absolute particular focus on how commissioners had been used to protect the rights of vulnerable groups. So we were very focused on commissioners who worked to protect human rights. We looked at what helps and what hinders in performing these roles, how the roles intersect and what lessons can be learned. It's maybe worth saying that for the research, there was an audience of both the Scottish Government and a lived experience panel, which was being set up to inform the bill development. So in terms of the method for the research involved a very brief literature review. The main purpose of that literature review was to inform the research tools and the discussions, so to inform the questions that we were going to ask the commissioners and to inform which commissions and commissioners we were going to involve within the research. We then held 11 interviews with commissions and commissioners who protect the rights of vulnerable groups, and 5 of these commissioners were in Scotland and 2 were out with Scotland. Just in terms of our findings from the literature review, we found there was very little published research or evaluation on the role or approaches of commissioners, and there wasn't consistent guidance in place for kind of designing the role of commissioners. Just very briefly, in terms of the findings for the interviews, we focused quite a lot on the powers that different commissions and commissioners had and the approaches that they took. Most of the people that we spoke to felt that they had the powers that they needed. The commissions and commissioners emphasised that they needed to have clear and well-written powers set out within law. Even if these powers weren't always used, it was useful to have these powers. People emphasised that it was a balance. They didn't want to use powers to punish people. They were focusing on improving outcomes and improving rights for vulnerable people. Most of the people that we spoke to felt that they had the resources that they needed to protect human rights, but they did feel that they needed to prioritise within their work. So they had clear plans for what their focus was each year. A few said that they would use a different approach if they had more resources. Some said that they would be more proactive, more collaborative, more focused on culture change, and would put a bit more resource into research and policy influencing than they were currently able to. There was some concern that as new commissioners were created, it would limit the powers of existing commissioners. And some of them emphasised this was particularly obvious in relation to their investigation powers, where there could be some overlap. Just briefly, in terms of governance, most of the commissions and commissioners we spoke to felt that their governance arrangements worked well. Some felt it was useful and helped with clarity to have a single commissioner, which created clear accountability and decision making. And some mentioned that a little bit of extra effort could be needed to clarify governance arrangements where more than one commissioner was in place. Some emphasised that over time, as the commissioner changed, they could have different approaches and it could lead to quite different approaches within the organisation. In terms of joint working, there were different arrangements in place. Some had very close joint working arrangements and written agreements in place with other commissions and commissioners, while others had more ad hoc arrangements depending on the focus of the work at the time. Commissions and commissioners felt that joint working arrangements were simplest where their roles were very clearly different and they could be clear about how each could contribute at the time. And they felt that joint working could really help where organisations had different powers, for example, a power to take cases while others couldn't, and they can link up and follow through on their work. Commissioners did emphasise that there could be some confusion sometimes about their mandates in protecting human rights, particularly when individuals are considering which commission or commissioner could help in terms of protecting and upholding their rights. So they emphasise that because there are still grey areas, there is absolutely a need for a structure for talking through how they work together on a day-to-day basis. We then asked a number of questions about how people felt about the creation of a new commissioner. Interviewees stressed that they would consider this in detail over time as the proposals developed. But in terms of initial reactions, there were some concerns that creating commissioners for particular groups could lead to a large number of commissioners. It could further complicate the existing landscape and could potentially confuse individuals. There was some concern that creating new commissioners could duplicate or reduce the value of existing commissioners. That's just a high-level overview of some of our findings, just as a way of introduction. Thanks.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that very helpful introduction. I noticed that you interviewed five of the commissioners. I'm just wondering if why you decided not to interview all seven in Scotland, just to ensure that all their views were heard.
Yeah, absolutely. So our focus was on commissions or commissioners that had been used to protect the rights of vulnerable groups. So what we did was we identified a long list of commissions and commissioners in Scotland and across the UK, because that was our brief, that could be included within that group, and chatted to the policy team about how to select the commissions or commissioners that should be involved. We were looking at commissions and commissioners who reported in different ways. So some that reported to Parliament, some that reported to government, some that reported to UK government, and some that reported to UK Parliament, and also beyond that in Northern Ireland and Wales. So we worked with the policy team to develop our long list into a short list and focused very closely on those that were intended to uphold the rights of individuals. And those where there was an interest in how their roles might potentially intersect with the role of a learning disability, autism and neurodiversity commissioner.
Okay, in your opening statement, you talked about the importance of improving outcomes, and Alzheimer's Scotland in its submission said that the financial cost of the changing landscape must be considered against improved outcomes. Through your research, have you identified whether or not the commissioners have been able to deliver improved outcomes for those that they are advocating for? And if so, can you give an example or two?
Yeah, that actually wasn't necessarily the focus of our work. The focus of our work was to look at the different powers that commissions and commissioners had and to explore how those powers were used. We didn't actually, I'm just going to check the discussion guide, we didn't actually have a question about any examples of where that had resulted in improved outcomes for individuals or for groups. So I don't think I would be able to comment on that.
No, it was just because you mentioned it in your opening statement. I wasn't actually originally intending to ask it to all of you. That's why I thought, because you mentioned the outcomes word, I thought I would just throw it in there. Ultimately, that's what they're trying to do, isn't it? I mean, the whole purpose of these commissioners is about looking at outcomes, and there is a concern about the lack of overall research. So I think it's important that we ascertain whether they are, in fact, delivering greater outcomes than if the commissioners did not exist, or if indeed there were other forms in which organisations and individuals could be assisted.
Yes, absolutely. I think the reason that I was mentioning improving outcomes is that people felt it was a balance in terms of their role. We were asking people questions about what powers they had and how they used them and what approaches they took. And I think what they were saying is they understood that their ultimate role was about improving outcomes for vulnerable people. But in using their powers, they wanted to be careful about that balance. They wanted to recognise that's their end outcome. So how do they best get there? How do they best use their powers to improve outcomes for vulnerable people?
Okay, another area you touched on in your opening statement was you talked about duplication. And you say in your report that one interviewee highlighted that the focus on creating more bodies to promote and support human rights did not support the findings of the CRERA review in 2007, which reviewed regulation, audit, inspection and complaints handling of public services in Scotland, and found out that scrutiny arrangements in Scotland were complex and aimed to simplify and reduce bodies. And the Deputy First Minister has contacted us about this particular issue in a, with regard to the strategic approach to the Commissioner landscape, and said that as agreed by Cabinet in last May, the Scottish Government's ministerial control framework aims to ensure decisions around the creation of new public bodies are made based on evidence and value for money, and that the first of the three principles she touches on are that new public bodies should only be set up as a last resort. Now, that's completely different, incidentally, from what the Times reported today, but talking about the Scottish Government wanting to double the number of commissioners or something. I certainly wasn't aware they were trying to do. So I'm just wondering how you view this whole issue in the context of your research about the number of bodies and duplication, how that can be avoided.
Yeah. So I think I can comment in terms of what the commissions and commissioners that we interviewed said to us could be other options and how that could be avoided. When we were speaking to people, they were very clear that they would absolutely welcome investment and resources in protecting the rights of vulnerable people, and that was the right thing to do. But people did have some questions about whether the creation of a commission or a commissioner was the way to go. Some alternative options that people suggested to us were more resources for existing organisations that champion human rights. So rather than creating a new organisation, investing in some of the existing organisations. More resources for existing commissioners, so that perhaps a strand of work could focus on protecting rights for certain vulnerable groups. Some suggested the creation of champions or advocates within public bodies who would really champion the rights, for example, in this case, of people with learning disabilities, autism and neurodiversity. Others suggested that a really core part of the work of a commission or a commissioner was actually about supporting good practice, and that there were other ways to do this than creating a commissioner. So some suggested investing more resources in supporting good practice in different ways. And then finally, some suggested an alternative could be creating a lead within an existing commission for, in this instance, learning disability, autism and neurodiversity. Now, some suggested that that would be an option, but some were very unsure about this option because they felt that the focus of a human rights organisation should be on protecting human rights for everyone. And they were unsure about whether if you created a lead for one group, they would require to create a lead for all sorts of different groups, and weren't sure where that would end.
Yes, I mean, yeah, page 55 of your report, which you've touched on there, I think that's a really important part of your report, because it does look at how this isn't the only game in town. The organisations, one could argue, are looking for specific outcomes, improved outcomes, and then perhaps see commissioners as a way of getting there more easily than constantly having to battle for additional resources. Would that be correct?
I'm not sure. I think where the commissions and commissioners that we were speaking to were coming from, where this was, we were speaking to them at quite an early stage in terms of the development of a new commissioner for learning disability, autism and neurodiversity. And they were saying, just in terms of early reflections, you're absolutely right. It's about the outcomes for protecting human rights. It's, there are different ways to get there. And while a commissioner or a commissioner may work in some instances, there are other options which it would be worth considering.
I mean, one of the things I found interesting, certainly in with regard to the submissions that we received as distinct from your report, is that a lot of the existing commissioners aren't too enthusiastic about additional commissioners. So, for example, the Children and Young People's Commissioner of Scotland said, and I quote, "The proliferation of commissioners' offices will be a costly exercise and may not provide good value for money for taxpayers, especially if there are multiple bodies tasked with intervening on similar or identical matters. Did you find in your research that there was a kind of something of a resistance to from the commissioners themselves and those bodies to extending the remits to more commissioners?
Yeah, again, I think people were very reflective when they spoke to us and were very clear that this was early on in the stage of development of a potential new commissioner. So they emphasised that over time they would be considering any clearly developed proposals and responding to that. But we definitely, when we asked about how roles could interact and the potential creation of a new commissioner, there was definitely some concern about potential duplication. Some of the people that we spoke to stressed that it was extremely important to make sure that if there was a new commission or commissioner, that it didn't duplicate existing activity, and that really importantly, it didn't take powers away from existing commissioners. And as I said in the introduction as well, I do think that some were concerned that it could create quite a lot of confusion among individuals about which specific commission or commissioner would protect their rights, in which circumstance should they go to the right commission or commissioner.
Now, one of the issues, of course, is that in terms of commissioners, they seem to develop in different ways. Do you think there's... you know, there's an argument for having a much more coherent approach to the development and creation of new commissioners?
So I was appointed to do this one specific bit of research and gather the views of the interviewees that I spoke to. So I'm not sure that I'm best placed to feel that I have a view on that. I think that the people that I spoke to felt that it might be useful to consider the duplication and overlap and roles of commissioners. But I don't think that I should be expressing an opinion on that.
OK, I'll try not to stray too far from your own research then. It is very tempting, of course. But I'll just ask you a couple more questions. And one is there's talk of, obviously, when a commissioner is restricted to 3 to 5 years and then they're replaced by another commissioner. But I didn't see anything in your research, so let me know if I've missed it, about sunset clauses, i.e. it seems to be that once commissioners are in existence, you know, I would expect that, you know, when a commissioner sets up, there's lots of energy and enthusiasm. You know, they've probably think, oh, there's things that we want to do for the last 10 years. Now we've got a commissioner, we can press ahead and do it, et cetera, et cetera. But then one would think that a lot of what they would hope to deliver would start tailing off, perhaps. So is there an argument, perhaps, for a sunset clause so that, for example, when a new commissioner when a commissioner steps down or retires, then it should be looked at to see whether or not that body should continue, actually, you know, if it's completed its tasks or if indeed a new commissioner should be appointed.
Yeah, again, that wasn't something we explored through the research. I looked back at our discussion guide and we had a lot of questions that we wanted to explore with each commission and commissioner. And we had some questions which were optional, depending on the amount of time that people had available. Most of the questions on governance and resources were optional, and we only had 2 questions on that strand, and in some cases we didn't have enough time with the relevant interviewee to explore that, so that kind of issue wasn't explored in depth. The only thing that we did come across that was kind of similar or related was we had, I think, one interviewee who mentioned that the approach of one commissioner when they left could be very different to the new commissioner that came in. So they recognised that they were working in very different ways. I didn't speak to anybody who felt that their work was reducing over time. I spoke to lots of people who felt that there was always more to do, and with more resources, they could do more. I did speak to some people who felt very much that the approach of the organisation changed over time, that they were set up, that they had new powers, that they wanted to show that they were able to use those powers, and maybe came in, used the powers in key cases or key examples where people would notice the impact they were having. But then over time, they would shift more to cooperation, best practice, standards, working jointly with organisations. So there were some that talked about absolutely a change over time, but I don't think I spoke to anybody who said that their work was reducing. It was always that there was more to do and it was a case of prioritising.
Yes, I've certainly all had significant increases in the resources in the current financial year, not least for staffing. I mean, one of the issues, of course, for this committee is the scrutiny by the Scottish Parliament corporate body. Now, in the responses we've had now in our submissions, and obviously I'm not going to quote any submissions because obviously you won't have seen them probably, but they all seem to feel that they're being well enough scrutinised. My understanding is there's only 1.5, possibly 2 members of staff dedicated to scrutinising them from the Scottish Parliament corporate body. Is that something that you're familiar with, about the kind of level of scrutiny? They all seem to be marking their own homework and saying, aye, the scrutiny that we're receiving is excellent. But I'm just wondering from your perspective if you feel, if there's anything that you want to comment on in that regard.
Yeah, I'm really sorry, but our research didn't focus on scrutiny of commissions or commissioners, so unfortunately I'm not able to comment on that.
I didn't think you would, but I thought it would be worth a punt. Okay, let's open up the session to colleagues. First to ask questions will be Liz, to be followed by John.
Good morning, Ms McMillan. You've been very clear to the committee that you had a very specific remit, and that was really about advocacy for disability and autism in their vulnerability. Nonetheless, your report from March 2023, I have it here, your title is The Role of Commissions and Commissioners in Scotland and the UK. Does it strike you that perhaps the very specific remit that you had doesn't quite fit with that title?
Perhaps, yes.
Can I just pursue this a little bit? Because this committee, with all due respect, is looking at the big picture. Not only do we need that from the overview, the scrutiny for this committee, but also from the cost aspect. And therefore, when I see that title, that's exactly what we're wanting to look at, is the role of commissions and commissioners in Scotland, and obviously the impact that the UK may have on that as well. I think that the issue that we have is to look at commissioners who have different roles, and you've been very clear that the research that you've been doing has been about advocacy for one particular group. But there are other commissioners, some of whom are handling complaints. There are some with a regulatory basis to them, and that there are some who are investigatory. And I think we want to have some idea of where that whole picture sits. So in the specific remit that you have you any concern that there isn't an overall strategy about where that bigger picture might lie?
I'm so sorry if you feel that the research isn't useful or covering all the issues.
I didn't say that at all. I'm saying is it's only part of the bigger picture. And what I'm asking in relation to the title that you presented us with, which is the one that I think we want to delve into, the specific role that you have, I would have thought would raise questions about the overall strategy for commissioners in general. And I'm just asking if that's something that came up either with your own research or from the people to whom you spoke.
So in terms of the research, title and focus was agreed with the Scottish Government policy team that we worked with. So that's why the research has that title. I appreciate that it maybe isn't appropriate. And the remit was set very clearly by Scottish Government. In terms of a strategy or overall approach to commissioners, again, that's not something we specifically asked. We were asked to look at the particular creation of one new commissioner and to explore that with commissioners. And we were also asked to explore kind of powers and approaches and joint working. So we were asked to explore kind of certain particular things. So I don't think I'll be able to comment on that. That's not something that we asked.
I understand fully that you've been looking at one specific aspect. You've said that several times now. I understand that. But does that not raise questions about the overall role that commissioners and their respective staffing arrangements have as to how best they are serving Scotland. Has that not even come through your research at all?
That wasn't something that we were exploring. I mean, we were looking at duplication between and joint working between and ideas on the creation of one particular commissioner. But I don't think that in terms of an overall strategy, I really don't think that's something that came up in the research.
But if you are looking at potential overlap, that means you're obviously, comments must have been provided about other commissioners. Does that not raise questions as to how well... Put it this way, do you think there should be a strategy about the overall aspect of commission?
So again, I really don't feel like I'm able to comment on that. We spoke to individuals about their views and reported on that and produced research on that. I really don't feel like I'm best placed to comment on whether there should or should not be a strategy.
Okay, could I ask one more question then, which is very specific about the issue of the Autism Learning Disability Commissioner. Do you feel that the demand for that new commissioner was a result of the fact that these vulnerable groups are not being as well looked after by other groups in, who might look after their needs? Has that arisen because there is a gap in the care that they fully deserve and to which they're entitled? Has that come about because of these gaps, or is this something that is in addition to the care that they provide?
Again, I'm not sure I'm best placed to answer that question. We were asked to speak to existing commissioners about their roles, their powers, their views on this commissioner, not particularly why this need or issue arose. I know that the Scottish Government policy team has done quite a lot of consultation on why people believe that there is a need for a commissioner, and I know that the views that came back were very mixed. So some people felt that there absolutely was a need for a commissioner, and some people felt that there absolutely wasn't. So I think there are very mixed views on whether a commissioner is needed in terms of learning disability, autism and neurodiversity. So I'm not sure I can comment further on that.
Thank you, convener.
Okay, thank you. Joined to follow by Michael.
Thanks very much, convener. One of the points I picked up, I think it was one of the interviewees in your report, it was on page 54, starts off talking about the government being enthusiastic about commissioners, and making the point it's becoming very confusing what a commissioner is. Now that the phrase commissioner is starting to lose its value in terms of what it is, do you think there's an issue that commissioner just seems to mean quite a lot of different things in quite a lot of contexts?
Yes, I definitely think that came through from the interviews that we held, that it does mean lots of different things. And when you speak to commissions and commissioners, they are taking lots of different approaches. They have lots of different powers and they're set up in lots of different ways. So I absolutely do believe that there are lots of different ways in which a commission or commissioner can work. And in some cases, that's because of the way that they have developed with the people whose rights they are protecting. And that's why they have developed in that way. But definitely some mentioned that it was in some cases creating some issues in terms of joint working, potential duplication, and requirement to think about where additional commissions or commissioners are created, thinking very carefully about that landscape.
Yeah, because I think you and we are kind of understanding the area that we're looking at, but there's other commissions altogether. Like, we also deal with the Scottish Fiscal Commission, which is completely different from any of this, but we still call it a commission with commissioners and things. I mean, did you pick up at all that the public get a bit confused by this, or even the organisations themselves?
Yeah, so the organisations that we spoke to mentioned that both members of the public and within the organisation could be confused about which commissioners have particular roles, how those roles interact, how they protect human rights, and how they best support the people that they're working for. So yes, absolutely, we did pick up from the interviews that there could be grey areas, and organisations are working very hard to make sure that they reduce those grey areas. They have written agreements in place where they're working on particular issues. They work closely together with another relevant commission or commissioner, but they mentioned that there can still be grey areas within the organisation, so they need constant communication, good joint working arrangements, but also that there could potentially be some confusion out with the organisation, with the public.
And I think you made the point already to the convener that, you know, even when if we just look at one commission, say the Children's Commission or whatever, when the commissioner changes, their approach to that can be quite different from the previous commissioner. Is that because we've given them quite a lot of scope and they can work within that, rather than if the role was more clearly defined, then they would be more fixed as to what they do?
Gosh, that's interesting. We didn't get into that level of detail about why there were such different approaches, but it was very clear in some instances that one commissioner can take a very different approach than another. For example, in terms of things like joint working and different approaches, and I suppose that will be about the individual and how they believe the outcomes are best achieved and what methods and approaches they should use. They have a range of powers and a range of approaches, and it's clear that they can be used in lots of different ways. So I suppose each individual will have different views about how those are best used.
Okay, thanks. I mean, one of the differences that came up, which she said, I think it's page 33, and I think this is kind of following on from a previous question, that some commissions and commissioners are looking at very much at individual cases and some are much more looking at systemic issues. And I just wonder, is that because of the way they've been set up and what they've been told to do?
Yes, absolutely. So there are some commissions and commissioners that don't have the power to take individual cases, whereas there are others where supporting individuals is their main role. So the way the powers are set up for the commission and commissioner will influence what approach they take. So some won't be able to get involved in individual cases at all. Some felt that their strongest power was around inquiry and investigation, so taking a thematic issue or a particular issue and exploring that in depth, while others felt that they actually weren't able to do that because they didn't have the power to establish what they were going to investigate. They had to respond to the cases that were coming through from individuals. So absolutely very different approaches depending on the way the powers are set up, but also on how the commissions or commissioners decide to use those as well. So some were very clear that they had quite clear powers that they were able to use, but either they had never used them or they had decided to very, very rarely use them because they wanted to work in a way which fostered cooperation, good practice, higher standards without going to the use of powers.
And would you say then that they just adapt to the powers they have and get on with it, or did you pick up a kind of level of frustration either from the commissioners or even from outside bodies that you know, some of them wanted to be doing other things but couldn't?
Yes, there was definitely a level of frustration in some instances and some of the people that we spoke to, that they felt it would be useful to have more powers or certain powers that weren't specified within law.
Now, I don't know if how you said you were limited sometimes by time and how much you could ask people, but I picked up somebody had said to you, I don't think that given the chance to start things from scratch, you would choose to create the institutional landscape that you have now. And I just wondered if you explored that any further with them or with anyone else as to, you know, if we were starting from scratch, what would we do now?
No, unfortunately, we didn't explore that. I think we did explore what other options you might use for a commission or a commissioner. We did explore how the interrelated, joint working, potential duplication, but that's a very interesting question, but we didn't explore that in terms of the overall context for commissions and commissioners. We did ask what alternatives might you suggest to a commissioner in this particular instance for learning disability, autism and neurodiversity. And we've already talked about the responses people gave there.
Okay, and again, perhaps following on from that, because one suggestion I think has been that the Scottish Human Rights Commission should just do everything and then should have within it departments or individuals or spokespersons or whatever to look at different aspects. And I think it had been, you picked up particularly that elimination of discrimination against women had been particularly suggested to them as a possibility. Can you just tell us what their reaction to that was and how, if that was likely to be a difficulty, if they seemed to think that was a difficulty?
Yeah. So in the interviews that we did, for research ethics, we have to be very careful about making sure that when we report what we're seeing, we report it anonymously. So I can tell you what everybody thought about that concept, but I can't tell you specifically what the SHR thought. We did hear that there was, from some, that might be an option. So creating a lead within an existing commission for a particular group. And in this case, we were looking at learning disability, autism and neurodiversity, but equally, as you mentioned, for women and girls, I know that issue has come up. But some were interested in that idea and felt that that could be a way of making sure that there was protection for certain groups of people within the system without having to create a new commission or commissioner. However, some did not think that that was a good idea and were concerned that that would result in the creation of a wide range of different leads within the organisation for lots and lots of different interest groups. So I think there was some interest in the idea, but there was also some concern about the idea as well.
Although, I mean, this isn't your view, obviously, but I mean, the fact that they said they would lead to a wide range of different leads seems slightly ironic to me, because we are facing a wide range of different commissioners instead of leads. So it sounds like we're going in the same direction, but...
The other concern, absolutely, I mean, people had different views there. I think the other concern that people brought up in relation to that was that human organisations that are protecting human rights should be protecting the human rights of all. So there was some concern about whether, if there are particular strands and leads, whether that would still fulfil their requirement to protect the human rights of all. So that was the only other issue that came up in that regard.
Okay, that's been very helpful. Thanks. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, John. Michael, to be followed by Jamie.
Thanks, Convener. Obviously, Ms McMillan, we're trying to draw some of the broader lessons from your report as it applies to the kind of just at the outset of our inquiry, and it's been useful so far. I think it's quite clear to me that you're saying that there is a lack of coherence across the landscape. I think that comes through quite strongly in your report. Is that fair?
Yes, I think that's fair that people were concerned about duplication and joint working arrangements.
And also, it jumped out to me that you said, and I think it's coming through the questions that my colleagues are asking, that you observe in the report that there is, and I quote, very little published research in this area. And you go on to say that there's little evaluation exploring the pros and cons of different approaches. So really, at the outset of this inquiry, we are working from the basis of very little published work exploring this area. And that's where you found yourself as well. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct.
Yeah. And did you find that you then went about a process of those structured interviews, having conversations with that limited number of people. But it's probably fair to say that it's quite difficult to draw a broader framework which you were basing that evaluation on.
Yes, and that wasn't necessarily the role of the research. Yes.
Okay, I can hear on that. And you already, colleagues, obviously, I think the committee through this inquiry is going to be quite concerned about talking about outcomes as politicians and trying to understand how the commissioner landscape best provides for better outcomes for specific groups of people in Scotland and for the broader population. And you're, I think, whereas you've said that that wasn't the purpose of your research either, to evaluate the outcomes of it, you do state that there was the evidence that you gathered indicated scepticism from different parts of the communities in relation to this proposal, that a commissioner would lead to better outcomes. Is that correct?
Almost. So the research that the Scottish Government policy team had already done before we did this series of interviews indicated to them that there was some scepticism about whether a commission or a commissioner was the correct approach, or perhaps not scepticism, but some different views about whether a commission or commissioner was the right approach from members of the public and from other organisations. So we didn't speak to members of the public at all.
Okay. And I suppose I'm keen to get your any observations across this work around the causality in this, in terms of the relationship between better outcomes and almost the theory of change, if we could put it that way, between having a commissioner, as understood by the people you spoke to, and the idea that it might come out with better outcomes. So not asking you to comment on the outcomes themselves, but actually that theory of change in terms of that person being appointed and the idea that things might get better.
Yes, I suppose when we spoke to... So we didn't speak to members of the public or any wider organisations at all in this research. We spoke to a limited number of commissions and commissioners. And when we spoke to them, they were unsure about whether the creation of a commission or a commissioner was the correct way to go, and whether there were other options that, as you see, could better protect or advance the rights of the group that we were looking at. And we've talked about those other options. The commissions and commissioners suggested that there could be other ways to go. Everybody that we spoke to was very clear that at the time we were speaking to them, these proposals were in their very early stages. So they were clear that as work progresses, they would engage with it, they would respond, they would write written papers, they would respond to consultations. So there would be much more work. So this was very early stage responses to something that was just an idea or a proposal. It hadn't been developed in any kind of clear proposal that people could respond to. It was just a concept at that stage.
Okay. And so none of that was really based, as far as you could determine, their experience of other commissioners?
Nobody mentioned that, no. I mean, there was some discussion about how they had to be very careful not to duplicate the work of other commissioners, and that they had to work very closely on a day-to-day basis with others. I couldn't comment on whether it was based on their personal experience of other commissioners. Sorry.
On page 6 of your report, you mention the accountability gap. I wonder what's meant by that phrase, the accountability gap.
Accountability gap. The report, the cross-party group on autism recommended in its report the accountability gap. Is that what you're referring to?
I suppose I'm wondering what that area. So there's also a mention in there about the need to bridge the gap between good intention and policy and practice on the ground, as referenced in the report. And I just, is that what's meant by that space? I suppose I'm trying to dig into this kind of idea about the purpose of one of these things, and I'm not really sure what that accountability mechanism means.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I think probably that would be something that the cross-party group on autism would have to comment on, or I could go away and have more of a look at the report and come back to you on that. But I'm sorry, I can't actually comment on that at the moment.
That's fine. There's some concerns raised then that this could be the establishment of a commissioner could be a drain on resource, in essence a substitution. So would we be better off spending the money on actual direct services or interventions rather than a commissioner? Did that come through some of the evidence that you took?
Yes, absolutely. So when we spoke to people about the idea of a new commissioner, there was some concern about that kind of duplication and a suggestion that perhaps investing more resources in existing organisations that support or advance the rights of the group that we were considering may be an alternative approach, absolutely.
Okay. And I wanted to close then with around about the process of establishing, essentially you were kind of almost a participant in that, providing the background research to this idea about that the government department was approaching. And I was intrigued by this, the quote that's on page 9 of your report, which said, the campaign for a commissioner had been done to their communities, not with them, as a feeling that correspondents had. That's evidence that you've taken. And I suppose it probably talks to some of the concerns maybe that the committee in terms of the policy-making process of establishing a commissioner at the outset of this, that is this something that is a kind of a politician's or a third sector idea rather than something that's based in the community of people that the commissioner is meant to be serving?
Yeah, again, so this was evidence that was provided to the policy team within Scottish Government, so not evidence that was provided as part of our research. So this was kind of a response from various organisations to the Scottish Government policy team, who then assessed that there. So that's not something that we spoke in any more detail with people about, unfortunately.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Jamie, to follow by Michelle.
Thanks very much, Convener. Some of the points I was looking to make have been covered by Michael Murrow, but I do want to focus a little bit on the outcomes side. In your report, obviously it's informing discussion and consultation on the potential setting up of a new commission or commissioner. And in the introduction to your report, you say the research was to provide a nuanced understanding of how commissioners effectively complete their functions working jointly with others. Surely evaluating outcomes would be part of that.
So what we were asked by the Scottish Government policy team to focus on was what powers the different commissions and commissioners had and the approaches that they took and how they used those powers, basically. So that was the main focus of the research. We were not in any way evaluating the commissions or commissioners that we spoke with. It involved 1 to 3 interviews with each of the commission or commissioners involved, and it wouldn't be possible to undertake any sort of evaluation in that regard. We were gathering the views and opinions of the people that we spoke with about what powers they had, what approaches they took, and towards the end, their views on how that might interact and work jointly with any new commissioner for learning, disability, autism and neurodiversity.
Okay, thank you. So in this report that you've been asked, the remit for this report that you've been asked to do by the Scottish Government, actually evaluating whether the outcomes of commissioners, what the outcomes of having commissioners was not part of what you were asked to do, just to be very clear on that.
We were not asked to evaluate the commissions or commissioners, no.
I mean, do you find that slightly surprising that looking at, as I say, being asked to conduct a report on a potential new commission or commissioner, you're not asked to evaluate the outcomes of other commissioners? You're asked to look at all the governance and other aspects and overlap, but not actually on whether they work.
I think that the research was commissioned to fulfil a particular purpose, to understand, as the government was looking at developing the potential new commissioner, to understand what powers or approaches might be useful for that commissioner to have. It was a reasonably small bit of work. It involved, as I say, 11 interviews in total and a very brief literature review. In terms of scope and scale, it was absolutely not surprising that we weren't asked to evaluate the other commissioners. That would be a much, much larger piece of work. That was just what the team was interested in, was this, the powers, the approaches, the understanding of how they work jointly, and how a new commissioner might kind of influence that or be be involved in that.
Thank you. Okay. And I mean, as far as you're aware, what reports are there? What analysis is there? Has there been done of the, I suppose, the outcomes or the success of commissioners in fulfilling their duties? Has there been a widespread piece of work done on that?
So in terms of overall reports on kind of commissioners and the roles of commissioners, there is very little research. I would imagine that each organisation probably undertakes reviews of various different powers and bits of work and evaluations, but that's not something that we were asked to look at, so that's not something that I can comment on in detail.
Okay. I mean, you'll appreciate the difficulty. We're looking at the landscape and a number of areas of the work of commissioners, how they overlap, as I say, their government's accountability, the financial costs. But we can't seem to pin that down to actually what they achieve for the people they're meant to be achieving those things for. And you know, there are certain specific areas as well. For example, I represent the Highlands and Islands. I want to see if there's any issues around rurality and some of the impacts on that, which other groups have missed out. Unless we have an idea of outcomes, would you accept that our ability to do that is limited or limited by that lack of detailed information on outcomes?
I'm sorry, I haven't done a review of what evidence there is of outcomes of commissions and commissioners, so I'm unfortunately not able to comment on that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Michelle.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us. I've just got a couple of quick questions as well. I mean, obviously, you've stated in the report that it was the Scottish Government commissioned you, but can I just check, it was the same directorate that's looking at introducing a new commissioner for learning disability, autism and neurodiversity? Was it the same directorate that commissioned you to look at that?
So it was the learning disability, autism and neurodiversity team, policy team, yeah.
Okay. Right, okay. So in other words, it's in their interests potentially to limit the scope of what you would evaluate in your research. Let's imagine for a minute that they're keen on introducing a new commissioner for their area of interest. It would make sense, therefore, to limit, as you set out today in your evidence, the scope of what you are asked to evaluate in terms of the wider landscape. Is that a fair assessment?
I'm not sure that that is fair. I think that in their review and exploration of whether a new commissioner was required, the evidence was very balanced about whether there should or should not be a new commissioner. They had done some good work already, gathering lots of different views about whether people felt that a commissioner was necessary or not, and the views were very mixed. And I think they were just interested in finding out more information about how a commissioner could work to have the appropriate powers, to have the right approach, to work jointly with others. So you would need to ask them, but I don't think that that is what happened in terms of the development of the research, and it didn't feel unusual or anything like that.
But as you set out in your statement there, they want there to be a new commissioner for this area, and that's certainly a statement of fact. And yes, you've obviously found out some other incidental stuff, but as Ms. Smith pointed out at the start of our session, we're looking at the wider landscape, if you like, independence, governance, accountability, cost, budget lines, overlap, underpinned by strategic positioning and, of course, critically, outcomes. And it sounds very much like you were given a different brief to look more gently at the concept of introducing a further commissioner by the directorate that wants to introduce a further commissioner.
I'm not sure I can comment on that. I think you'd probably need to ask the directorate about that. Okay.
And can I ask then, what reception did you get to your research, and have you met with them subsequently to it and taken any feedback from them? If so, what was that?
Yep, so we produced the report in early 2023. The government provided some minor comment on the report. We finalised the report in early 2023, and since then I have been in touch with them once to let them know that I was coming to this evidence session.
Okay, thank you. Do you think there's a possibility that the report was commissioned to neutralise objections, given that this committee was going to be doing this work to looking at the landscape?
Certainly that was not something that ever came up. I didn't know about this committee. That wasn't a conversation that we had.
Okay, thank you. And last week's question, you mentioned earlier about human rights. Did any of the discussions about, you know, the concept of a number of different commissions or commissioners looking at that, the complexity around an emerging almost hierarchy of rights? We've seen in this Parliament some challenges with recognising different sets of rights, and almost, and we see that in the wider environment as well. Was there any recognition that creating a hierarchy of rights can be problematic, or did it not go to that depth?
I would say that wasn't something that came up specifically. The only way in which that came up really was when we were looking at when some people suggested alternatives to a commissioner, and some people suggested a potential lead within an existing commissioner for a particular group. And then others talked about, well, is that appropriate? How many leads would we need to have? Are we still protecting the human rights of all? Are we still meeting our requirements as a human rights organisation? So I'd say that's probably as close as we got to that really important conversation.
Okay, thank you very much. That's all, convener.
Thank you very much. I mean, I can understand there's an element of frustration from members of the committee, because, I mean, we've seen the research, and I can understand you've only undertaken the research you were commissioned to do. You've been asking people about whether they support a new commissioner, or whether they think the resource could be better allocated. But, you know, it's a kind of two-dimensional exercise, wouldn't you agree, without actually being able to know what the potential outcomes will be in terms of either improvements or not, as the case may be, through having a new commissioner?
Perhaps. When we spoke to people, they were very clear that they had already been involved in conversations about the potential development of this new commissioner, and that they would expect to be involved in many, many more conversations about this potential development over time. So I suppose this was an exercise that fulfilled a certain purpose. It absolutely didn't cover all of the issues that you're looking at, and I completely understand that, but it had a particular purpose and role, and the interviewees were very clear that it was part of that journey, that they understood that they would be involved in further conversations as things progressed.
Okay, I'll just finish then with one issue that came up in your report. You said in page 13, you said, and I quote, "In Scotland there's a range of commissions and commissioners. However, there is very little published research on commissioners and no handbook or blueprint within government for designing the role." Do you think there should be?
Again, I think I'm not best placed to comment on that. I was researching and speaking to...
Based on the research, based on the discussions, I mean, you've got to understand the frustration of the committee. We're looking for some kind of answers, some kind of lead, some kind of steer. You've undertaken this comprehensive research. It's not as comprehensive perhaps as we'd like, but it's a not insubstantial document. You've covered a lot of ground. And, you know, speaking to the people you've spoken to, do you not feel that, you know, there should be a more... you know, a more robust mechanism for developing these commissioners, should we say? But you've heard it yourself. You know, you've actually said there's no handbook or blueprint within government for designing the role. The implication from that is that you surely feel there should be one.
I suppose we're just stating a fact there isn't. And from speaking to... it's difficult. I mean, from speaking to the interviewees that I spoke to, some were clear. I mean, they're very different organisations. They are very different. And the organisations that we spoke to all reported in different ways. So not all reported to Parliament. They were all set up in different ways. So I really don't feel that I'm best placed to answer that. I think that's something that probably commissions and commissioners or others within the Scottish Government system would be better placed to answer. I don't have a view on that.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Are there any further points you want to make to the committee before we wind up?
No, thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much for giving your evidence today. We'll continue taking evidence in relation to our inquiry into Scotland's Commission on Landscape at our next meeting on Tuesday, 23rd of April. And in fact, before then, we're going to have a private session with regard to this particular issue, in which we'll discuss some other aspects of it. So, that being the only public item on our agenda today, I now close the public part of this meeting and call a 5-minute break. Thank you very much.